How did you find out about the brain? By Isaac Asimov. Read by Rogério Fonseca. Inside the skull. Inside the head is a soft, grayish mass that weighs just about 3 pounds. It's wrinkled and it looks a little bit like a large walnut. It's the brain. It doesn't seem to do anything. It just sits there. Yet, it must be very important since, for one thing, it's surrounded by a protective shell of bone called the skull. No other part of the body is as well protected as the brain is. The heart, for instance, is a very important part of the body. It has the breastbone in front of it, and a series of ribs. There are spaces between the ribs, however. A knife can be pushed between the ribs and into the heart, and that would kill a person at once. There are no openings in the skull. Then, too, the body needs a gas called oxygen, which is found in the air. We are constantly breathing in order to get the oxygen into our body. The oxygen combines with food to give us energy. The muscles need a lot of oxygen, since they use up so much energy. When you use muscles a great deal, for instance, when you are running or lifting weights or chopping wood, you start to pant. You breathe quickly and deeply in order to get as much oxygen into your body as possible. Yet, for all the oxygen you breathe, 1/4 is used by the brain, even though it just seems to sit there and do nothing. This shows that the brain must be doing something important. Sometimes a person chokes so that he can't breathe and oxygen can't get into his body. Most parts of the body can do without oxygen for quite a while, but the brain can last only a few minutes if its oxygen supply is cut off. After those few minutes, the brain stops doing what it is doing and the person dies. Ancient people didn't know about the importance of oxygen to the brain. They didn't even know what oxygen was. Still, they did know that when a person was hit violently on the skull, he would be stunned for a while, and even after he came to, he might not behave as he usually did. Something would be wrong with his thinking and acting. For this reason, some scholars in ancient times thought that the brain might be the part of the body that enables human beings to think and feel. One of these scholars was Plato. The most influential of the ancient philosophers was a student of Plato's named Aristotle. It seemed to him that the heart was the center of thinking and feeling. After all, the heart speeds up when you are excited and slows down when you are resting. But if the heart does the thinking and the feeling, what does the brain do? Aristotle thought the brain was a place where the blood was cooled after it had been heated up by the heart. But if that's all the brain does, why is it so well protected by bone? Why is a blow on the head so much more likely to knock us out than a blow on the chest? Why is the brain so much larger in human beings than it is in other animals? Horses and camels, for instance, are much larger than human beings, yet have smaller brains than we do. Only huge elephants and whales have brains that are larger than ours. For all these reasons, some scholars were doubtful about Aristotle's theory about the brain, even though the philosopher had such a great reputation. About 290 before Christ, a Greek doctor, Herophilus, became the first person to cut open dead bodies before students. This is called dissection. In this way, students could study the different parts of the body. Such a study is called anatomy. Herophilus studied the brain carefully and decided, as Plato did, that it was the brain that did the thinking and feeling. He also notes that there were long, thin, thread-like objects that seemed to connect to the brain. We call them nerves. Herophilus found that some nerves extended to muscles and the others to the eyes and the ears. He decided this meant that some nerves control motions by making the muscles work, and the other nerves control the senses, what you see, hear, and so on. Following Herophilus was another Greek doctor, Erasistratus. He also studied the brain carefully. He was the first to describe the wrinkles and the folds in the brain's surface. We now call them convolutions. He pointed out that the human brain has more convolutions than is found in the brains of other animals. He felt that this was why human beings are more intelligent than other animals. He also noticed that the brain is in two parts. In front is a large part that we now call cerebrum. Behind and below, it's a smaller part that we call cerebellum. He also studied the membranes covering the brain and the spaces within the brain. Herophilus and Erasistratus did their work in Alexandria, Egypt, which was the center of science in those days. The Egyptian people, however, objected to dissection. It was against their religion. For that reason, the very good start these two doctors made was not followed up. At the time the Roman Empire was at its height, there was another Greek doctor of importance, Galen. He wasn't allowed to dissect human corpses, so he dissected animals. Sometimes this misled him, for there are parts of animals, such as dog and pigs, that are not exactly like those of human beings. He did work on another part of the brain. Behind the cerebellum, the brain narrows into a part called the medulla oblongata, and this ends in a kind of tail that is enclosed and protected by the bones of the spine, or backbone. This tail is called the spinal cord, and the nerves are attached to it, just as they are attached to the brain. Galen studied what happened if he cut an animal's spinal cord. If it was cut high up, near the brain, the animal died at once. If it was cut in places lower and lower down, different sets of muscles stopped working and they were paralyzed. This showed that the nerves attached to the spinal cord controlled various muscles. Unfortunately, science declined under the Romans. After the fall of the Roman Empire, science declined even further. It was not until 1,000 years after Galen that scientists once again began to dissect the bodies of animals and human beings, so as to study anatomy. In 1316, an Italian doctor, Mondino de Luzzi, wrote a book that was entirely on anatomy. It was the first all-anatomy book in history. He managed to get many things wrong, however, because he depended too much on what Galen had said and didn't do enough dissection of his own. Still, it was a beginning. To make his art more realistic, an Italian artist, Leonardo da Vinci, dissected at least 30 dead bodies and carefully drew the various parts he observed. He was the first to show that Galen was wrong in some ways. However, Leonardo didn't write about his findings in such a way that others could learn about them. He kept his findings to himself, and his notes on the subject were only discovered much later. The real founder of modern anatomy was a Belgian scientist, Andreas Vesalius. Like Leonardo, Vesalius dissected many dead bodies. However, he wrote careful descriptions for others to read. In 1543, he published one of the great books of science, Its title, in English, is On the Structure of the Human Body. Vesalius had it illustrated by one of the best artists of the time. By then, printing had been invented, and the book was printed and reached all the learned men of Europe. The book was accurate, and it corrected almost all of Galen's mistakes. Vesalius studied the brain and described it very accurately. He repeated the experiments of Galen on the spinal cord. He decided that the brain, the spinal column, and the nerves attached to them make up a nervous system. After Vesalius' time, people fearlessly dissected the human bodies and worked out the details of the various parts more and more clearly. Many anatomists followed the various nerves to see exactly where they go. A Swiss biologist, Albrecht von Haller, showed that muscles can be irritable. That is, they contract if they are touched. When Haller touched a nerve that led to a muscle, that muscle would contract. In fact, the nerve was more irritable than the muscle itself. A very light touch on the nerve was enough to make the muscle contract. Haller's work made it quite clear that the brain, to which the nerves are attached, controls bodily movements. What's more, Haller showed that all the nerves in the body can be traced back to the brain or to the spinal cord. Since the brain and spinal cord are attached to each other, this showed there is only one nervous system.